Hello and welcome to my talk. My name is Matthias Aengenheyster and I am presenting work done as part of my PhD at the University of Oxford. The 2013-14 winter season was quite anomalous in the Euro-Atlantic region. I am showing two examples of this on the right. On the top, the ocean heat convergence anomaly integrated over the top 50 meters. The strong anomaly in the North Atlantic is immediately apparent. On the bottom, the precipitation anomaly. One can see the strong wet bias over Western Europe, in particular the UK. This winter was also marked by a cold North America and strong surface heat loss from the North Atlantic. What we're asking is, what is the impact of such ocean heat convergence anomalies on European winter weather? The key result, to spoil it already in the beginning, is that the 2013-14 EGF North Atlantic ocean heat convergence anomaly had substantial local impacts, but limited non-local and dynamic consequences. How do we study this question? We want to do first, resolve changes in distribution and extreme events. So we're looking to use large ensembles. Second, we want to investigate the impact of a prescribed change in ocean forcing. This is difficult to do with typical SST forced models since they lack dynamic ASC interaction and an intuitive way to prescribe changes in ocean circulation. Therefore, we turn to a slab model, which we couple to our atmospheric HAT AM4 model, which gives us more realistic ASC interactions and an intuitive way to impose circulation anomalies. Let me briefly talk you to this model. We use a 50 meter depth, fixed depth slab ocean, shown at the bottom, that is forced from below with the ocean heat convergence, the Q flux, that represents the action of the large scale ocean circulation on the mixed layer. And at the top, we have ASC heat fluxes that emerge dynamically from the ASC interaction. The model also includes a simple sea ice model, where the sea ice is advected by prescribed sea ice velocities and exchanges also heat with the slab ocean. How do we get this Q flux that is so central to this work? There are different approaches, but in this particular study, we have the SST from observations that were observed in that particular winter season. We use this, shown in the top, as part of a calibration run, where we run the slab model forward and compare its internally generated SST to the observed SST that we want to emulate. This is converted to a correction, a heat convergence Q flux, that we write out as part of a 30-year calibration run, and from which we then compute a climatology of ocean heat convergence that we, in a further runs, in the control runs, can force the slab ocean with from the bottom. How does this calibrated Q flux compare to other data sets? In the gray shading in the top plot here, you can see the distribution of North Atlantic Q flux in DJF from the echo reanalysis. The black lines, in particular this look at the solid black line, which represents the 2013-14 season, you can see that it was in most months the most positive year. In the blue line overlaid by the orange is shown the heat convergence as calibrated from our calibration run. So in the DJF season, which is the focus of this work, the agreement is quite good. We see much larger deviations in other seasons, in particular in summer and winter. We believe this to be the case because the calibration inherits model biases, where we know that the model has a strong summer bias, and the Q-flux inherits this since the model is constrained to reproduce observed SST. Now we need a perturbation to our calibrated Q-flux. For this again, we turn to echo and look for a recent year that is most different from 2013-14. This turns out to be 2011-2012, and the difference between these 2 years is shown here in the top, again with the strong anomaly in the North Atlantic quite clear. We now generate our Q-flux perturbation by restricting this anomaly to the North Atlantic only, shown in the bottom panel, and subtracting it from our calibrated Q-flux. This then yields us the orange line with the perturbation shown in blue. With these two heat convergence patterns, we now force two slab atmosphere ensembles with around 800 members each using our fabulous climateprediction.net, our distributed computing system that we have at Oxford, which allows us to run these large ensembles. Since I'm presenting a new configuration here, I'm showing some validation comparing the slab atmosphere model to the atmosphere-only model as well as the reanalysis. Generally, one can say that mean climate and atmospheric variability are quite similar between the two configurations. Shown at the top right is the bias compared to AF5 of the 500 hectopascal geopotential height. On the left in HAT SM4 and on the right in HAT AM4. We are also reassured by the fact that both models are quite well capable to reproduce the tripolar structure of the jet latitude distribution of the North Atlantic eddy-driven jet, which, as we know, is important for winter atmospheric dynamics in the Euro-Atlantic region. It's also good to ask what's the performance of the sea ice models, which is clearly quite simple, and we find with some tuning that the model has an adequate winter sea ice reproduction of Arctic sea ice in this season. Comparing the sea ice concentration from HEAD-SM4 in March and to observations from Ostia. We do have somewhat of a high sea ice bias, too much sea ice concentration, and in particular too high sea ice thickness. The model shows a calibration-dependent SST bias. We had to find this out since we had small artifacts at some coastal points in our initial files used for the calibration. And this induced a significant, surprisingly big bias in the Q-flux, and then also thereby in the SST, as shown on the left. We believe this to be of secondary importance since both ensembles inherit the same bias, and therefore we can still compare like for like. But I want to point out that fixing these artifacts strongly reduces the SST bias. So the model is actually quite good in reproducing the SST with its Q-flux that we calibrate. Now let's look at some results. First, starting with the local dynamics in the North Atlantic. How does the local slab atmosphere system respond to the strong perturbation in Q-flux? Starting, this is the heat convergence that the two ensembles are forced with. In blue, showing the unperturbed ensemble, and in orange, showing the perturbed ensemble with the 2014 anomaly removed. This perturbation reduces the heat that is forced with in the North Atlantic by around 50%. The result of this forcing can now be seen in the heat content change over the DJF season in panel A, and in the heat flux integrated over DJF in the same box in panel B. So what we see is that around 2/3 of the forcing cools the ocean, reduces the ocean heat content, whereas around 1/3 of the forcing cools the atmosphere by changing the air sea heat flux. This then results in corresponding changes in SST and surface air temperature at the end of the forcing season in March, shown here the SST distribution and shown here the surface air temperature distribution at the end of the season. What's interesting about all these figures is that you can see a significant overlap between the ensembles, showing the importance of internal variability despite the strong forcing. So as I've showed on a previous slide, only about 1/3 of the forcing is available to perturb the atmosphere and impact atmospheric dynamics. We observe a cooling in the North Atlantic by around 1 Kelvin that spreads out into Western Europe, where we still see significant changes in distribution. Significance means here 95% on a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. When you look at this in the global picture, here on the left, you see that most of the forcing is really concentrated in the North Atlantic, and non-local influences are relatively small. The same story holds for other variables, for example, on precipitation, where we see, corresponding to the cooling, a local drying, a reduction of precipitation in the North Atlantic and in parts of Western Europe, but relatively little elsewhere. The changes to atmospheric circulation are relatively minor, for example, here shown the change in Z500 geopotential height, which is much smaller than interannual variability. And the Z500 anomaly also does not appear to project onto the NAO or other atmospheric dynamics, for example, on the autocorrelation function of the NAO of the North Atlantic Tripole in SST, their cross-correlation or other metrics such as regime occupancy, regime persistence, and so forth. One big reason why we did the study in the first case in the way I've shown is that we're interested in extreme events and their changes under changes in ocean forcing. Let's show how we do this. We are primarily interested in seasonal changes in this investigation. How wet was a particular winter season and how was the wetness of the winter season changed by the ocean forcing? So we look at DJF average precipitation over Europe and fit a generalized extreme value distribution, which then allows us to compute return levels. I'm showing this first for a number of regions that are shown in the map here at the top, where on the x-axis in the plot here at the bottom, you see the return period in years, how often one would expect an event of a given magnitude, where the magnitude is given on the vertical axis. Again, as on the previous slides, the blue lines represent the unperturbed ensemble and the orange lines represent the perturbed ensemble. So you can generally see that the orange line lies below the blue line, so the perturbation leads to a reduction in precipitation. However, this is not true everywhere, and the changes are most pronounced in some regions, for example, Western Germany and Scotland, whereas other regions see relatively little change. There are two ways to read changes from these graphs. One way is to draw a vertical line through this, look at a fixed return period, and deduce the change in intensity that results from the perturbation. The other way is to draw a horizontal line, look at a fixed return level, and see how the return period of this return level changes. Showing both of these ways as a map, which obviously have a high degree of correspondence, we see that the intensity of a 10-year event over Europe is reduced by up to 10% in parts of northern and northwestern Germany in Scotland, but not in other regions. For example, interestingly, not so much in southwestern England, which was so strongly impacted by the events of 2013-14. The corresponding change in return level is also quite significant in those same regions, turning a 10-year event approximately into a 20-year event. So though there it's quite noticeable. This reduction in precipitation is due to both to a reduction in mean precipitation by around 5% and a reduction in seasonal variability, so the ensemble spread, by around 10%. These changes are largely consistent with Clausius Clapeyron, so the corresponding changes in surface air temperature. Let me briefly present some conclusions to this work. I've presented a new framework for investigating air sea coupling under prescribed ocean circulation. I've successfully applied this to the study of the impacts of the 2013-14 Q-flux anomaly in the North Atlantic. In one sentence, removing this anomaly leads to cooling and reduced precipitation over Europe, which leads to notable regional changes in extremely wet winters, but we see limited non-local impacts and changes to atmospheric circulation. Comparing the sign of the response and the sign of the forcing to the same in observations leads us to conclude that the positive Q-flux anomaly in this winter was likely due to atmospherically forced surface heat loss rather than to a change in ocean circulation consistent with previous authors. Other work is currently investigating the importance of the coupling itself, so the feedback of SE heat fluxes on SST, on the statistics of SE fluxes, and on atmospheric variables. And with that, I want to conclude. Thank you very much.